was similar to what Professor Klauser talked about in Polish. Of course, the Poles composed 1/6 of the entire Grand Army. There weren't as many Italians, but nonetheless, there were several tens of thousands of Italians. Now, what we have to, I really want to emphasize, is that the Grand Army was not just a French army. It's well known, but sometimes when you read English literature about this war, they refer constantly to the fact that it was a French army, a French army, a French army. Actually, it was a European army. There were people coming from a variety of European nationalities: Polish, Italian, German, Austrian, Russian, Swiss, Lithuanian, Croatian, Spanish, Portuguese, Dutch, and Belgian. And if you, the Napoleonic army was even more diverse, if one includes the different German states like Bavaria, Württemberg, Baden, Westphalia, in Italy, the Kingdom of Italy, the Kingdom of Naples. In other words, it was really truly a European, European army. And here I would argue that without the fact that Napoleon recruited so many Europeans, he probably could not have established his Grand Armée. He probably could not have expanded to the degree that he did expand. And drafting so many soldiers from all over Europe also helped him with conscripting French, because there was a lot of resistance within France to the conscription, to the draft, and I think it was shown very, very well, the resistance in France, certainly. Drafting more soldiers from Europe helped to alleviate the pressure on the French army. So in sum, we really have to look at Napoleon militarily, as well as in many other ways, as a European leader and not just as a French leader. Now, I'm going to stress and to emphasize, as I'll do it more briefly than what I have here, and I'll talk about the Italian component, and also within Italy, there were approximately 50,000 Italians, some say 60,000 Italians, who actually marched into Russia. But I'm going to speak specifically about the Kingdom of Italy, which is an area in northern Italy consisting of Lombardy, Bologna, and Venice. Then, of course, you have southern Italy, which is a separate Italian state, the Kingdom of Naples, and then there are other areas like Piemonte and Tuscany and Rome that were annexed to the Roman Empire. Napoleon, as I said, recruited and drafted soldiers from all areas, but I will stress and talk about the Kingdom of Italy. Now, there were more than 27,000 soldiers that were marching with Napoleon into Russia from that area of of the Kingdom of Italy. There were also 8,300 horses, 740 oxen, and 58 cannons from that area. The Italian army was part of the four corps that was under the leadership of Eugene de Beauharnais. And Eugene de Beauharnais, right, the stepson of Napoleon, was also the viceroy of Napoleon in the Kingdom of Italy. And the four corps were together, had at least on paper, 52,000 infantry with more than 10,000 cavalry coming from France, Italy, Bavaria, and the Illyrian provinces. It consisted of four divisions: the 13th Division under General Alexis Delzon, who also died in Russia; the 14th Division under General Jean Boussier; and the 15th Division, that was strictly Italian, under General Domenico Pino. In addition to this, there was also a division of Italian Royal Guard, the Guardia Reale Italiana. The 15th Division of Pino had, of course, infantry, artillery, cavalry, and I would say there was a whole variety of soldiers. Altogether, approximately 15,000 soldiers in this 15th Division. The Italian Royal Guard numbered almost 6,000 troops with 263 officers. They also possessed 2,300 horses, and most of the members in this Royal Guard came from the property classes, from the aristocratic classes, and from the bourgeoisie. Now, marching into Moscow, and here the 15th Corps of Pinot really did not participate as much in the battles. In fact, to Borodino, they arrived a day later. In other words, they were not even in Borodino. And so there isn't really very much to say about the 15th Corps of Pinot on the march to Moscow. Their greatest feat in this Russian campaign was the Battle of Maloyaroslavets, right? Which, as you know, is a battle that the Napoleonic army fought on the way after the retreat from Moscow. And here the 4th Division, the 4th Corps of Eugene played a very, very big role, and the Italians paid a very, very heavy price. The Zone Division arrived first at Maloyaroslavets on the evening of 23 of October, crossed the river Luzha and occupied the town. The following dawn, Dokhturov, right, the Russian general's larger army, drove them out of most of the town. Aside from their superior numbers, the Russians had the advantage of attacking downhill toward the river valley. The Zon himself was killed, as was his brother. Soon, the 14th Division and Pinot's Italian 15th Division and the Italian Royal Guard arrived at the scene and joined the fighting. A fierce battle raged throughout the entire day. This is the 24th of October, 1812. The battle raged in the streets of Maloyaroslavets. One assault succeeded another. Both sides fought with immense tenacity. The town and its bridge changed hands several times, possibly as much as 11 times, if one is to believe the Russian general Bennigsen. Intense street combat raged, and burning houses crashed down on hundreds of wounded troops who were killed when they were unable to escape the blazes. General Pinot himself was wounded, continued to fight, but then was wounded a second time and had to be evacuated. Let me give you a very short, somewhat poetic, if you will, description of what was going on. The blending of smoke and flames was horrendous, furious, and tenacious. The face-to-face fighting was in the houses, in the streets, in the courts. Everywhere the blades of the bayonets flashed like mad serpents. Blood was flowing in the gutters, stagnated in ample wells, and splattered on the walls. The atrocious, grandiose scene that developed among the glares of the long tongues of fire produced a feverish, exciting fantasy and a vision of Dantesque hell. And yet, the sight of the dreadful wounds, the piles of cadavers, rather than depress the spirit of Italians, added to their ardor. Maybe some kind of idealization, but nonetheless, one gets the idea of what this battle of Maloyaroslavets was all about. Tremendous amount of casualties, thousands of casualties between dead and wounded on both sides. The battle ended at 11 o'clock at night with a victory of the 4th Corps of Eugene, of the Napoleonic forces. Many people, commanders, observers, praised very much the Italians. Let me give you a few quotations. The British general Robert Wilson, who watched the battle from the Russian lines, praised the Italian performance very highly. Quote, "The Italian army displayed qualities which entitled it evermore to take rank among the bravest troops of Europe. It has confronted and sustained in the earlier a superior and concentrated weight of artillery that might have daunted and subdued the firmness of the most resolute veterans. Later on in 1814, this is long after the campaign, he told a group of Italian and Austrian military personnel, quote, the Italian army at Malaga was Slavic surprised with their heroism. 16,000 brave Italian beat 80,000 of the army of Kutuzov. And there are a whole variety of other citations and quotations by other praiseworthy people who praise the Italian troops. For example, the French general Jean Rat said the Italian troops were covered with glory. It is a day that the army of Italy needs to ride in its magnificence. And yet, those eulogies of Italian courage could not hide the hideous spectacle. The morning after the battle, the town of Yaroslavets turned into ash and rubble. The bodies of dead men and burnt cadavers, many of them unrecognizable, were strewn throughout. Indeed, this savage engagement was very costly. Both sides suffered heavy casualties, about 5,000 dead and wounded on each side. In the Napoleonic army, the Italians paid the heaviest price. Many of the Italian casualties were officers, and I have a number of officers who were killed or who were wounded. I mentioned earlier Domenico Aquino. Now, of course, the problem about the victory at Yaroslavets is that it really brought nothing. And it gave Napoleon no advantage. In the words of Armande Colincourt, the victory success got us nowhere. Because the idea, of course, of Napoleon was to march south, but he realized that he won't be able to march south, he won't be able to face the army of Kutuzov, and then, of course, he returned to the same route that he marched into Moscow, which, of course, was all ravaged from the march on Moscow. I think this is a chapter that, of course, everybody is familiar with. And of course, this retreat was, of course, disastrous. It was disastrous for the rest of the Grand Army. It was disastrous also for the force corps of Eugène de Beauharnais, and of course, for the Italians. There were several episodes in which the Italians played a role, for example, the Battle of Vajazma. Then at a certain point, they had to cross river, which was a tributary of the Dnieper, and this was also a disaster. It was some kind of early version of the crossing of the Berezina. It was also a tremendous number of casualties, freezing water, a broken bridge, and so on and so forth. I don't have time here to read it. The numbers dwindled. And eventually, the crossing of the Berezina, of course, they were able to remain the remnants of the Italian Eugene Corps and the Italian division were able to cross the Berezina River on the night of the 27th to the 28th of October. After the Berezina crossing, of course, the Grand Army ceased to exist as an organized military force, essentially disintegrated into a throng of routed runways in full flight. Its number dwindled to a few tens of thousands. The four corps was reduced to fewer than 3,000 men. The demoralized Italian army continued to struggle against the freezing weather, lack of food, the lack of food supply, the Cossack attacks, etc., etc. More men, of course, were lost. And let me conclude here. The Russian campaign, of course, had disastrous consequences for Napoleon. The consequences for the Italian force were also very grim. Out of 27,000 early 1,000 men returned home. Okay, so the overwhelming majority were killed, wounded, became prisoners. All the artillery and animals were lost. When the news of the defeat arrived in Milan, the capital of the Kingdom of Italy, not surprisingly, the mood in the Kingdom of Italy turned gloomy. On 31st of December 1812, Francesco Melzi, a top official, wrote to Eugene, that most people view the current situation as very distressing, and I think this was probably underestimating, and was frightened by the prospects of a new campaign. Opposition to further conscription stiffened in the Italian kingdom in 1813. The defeat of in Russia shattered even Napoleon's image of invincibility once and for all and undermined his position in northern Italy. Thank you very much.